So I just want to echo what so many others have said before me, but thank you so much, Carrie, for inviting us here today and to connect us to your continuous exploration and gaze and promotion of our multidimensional selves. With that being said, I prepared a little something which looks at the quadruple consciousness that has informed who I am and what I do as a producer, a director, as an artist. So if you could roll the clip, please.
Jason, roll one, sound one.
Okay, Jason, go.
My name is Jason Holliday. My name is Jason Holliday. My name is Aaron Payne.
Thank you, Lisa. Thank you, Carrie, very much for inviting me to be here. One of the things when you create art is that other people see it and you never know how they might impact with it. And your art has impacted my life. but what I want to talk about is, so my name is Shola Lynch. I am a filmmaker and I'm also the curator, newly noted curator at the Schomburg Center for the Moving Image and Recorded Sound Division. I'm very excited about that. And as a filmmaker, I really think that my work is about framing. So I want to tell you a little bit about my framing and my narrative, and I will try and keep it brief. So as a child of the 70s, I grew up here in New York City, and the album that dominated my world and framed my point of view is called Free to Be You and Me. Is anybody here familiar with that album, right? Free to Be You and Me, Marlo Thomas, where we were basically taught, this was post-60s, we were taught we were individuals. Malcolm and Martin had taken care of the race thing. Gloria and the gals had worked out the gender issues, and I could be a complete individual. Okay, fast forward, college. I go to the University of Texas, the University of Texas in Austin. I went as an athlete and a scholar, and I discovered along the way that black woman, athlete, scholar, honors program, that I was improbable, P people would always ask, so how is that possible? Who are you and where do you come from? And the answer was always, oh, from New York, and oh, her mother's white, as though that explains any kind of eccentricities or outside the box, the stereotyping. But college is such a great place because it's also a place of exploration. And so I delved into women's history, I delved into black history, I delved into black literature, where I found narrative, when I found stories about people of color that I could relate to. But I also discovered language and how important language was. And I stumbled upon a term that I want to share with you called symbolic annihilation. And it was a feminist term that came out of the late 70s to describe the lack of media images of women that were nuanced. So it was partially about lack, but it was also that the portrayal of the images that we did see were of incompetence, and they denigrated through victimization and trivialization. So when somebody couldn't see me and would ask, are you really black, what is blackness, all of this, they were essentially saying that I didn't exist. And so I became furious, and my relationship with history became, you know what, I exist, and I always existed, so let me go find myself. And in that exploration, I turned to photography. And part of why I was so touched by discovering Carrie's photographs, Lorna Simpson's photographs, Adrian Piper's photographs, is they really gave me a sense of myself in place and in time, and that sense of play. And this idea of narrative and reclaiming and unearthing the evidence of us. And that's kind of how I ended up in curating. Graduated from with a master's in American history and public history resource management, thought I would curate historical evidence and bring the evidence of us to life. Couldn't find a job doing that, but did land a job with a filmmaker where I got to curate for film, Ken Burns, telling sweeping historical stories that didn't always include me. So after 5 years, I became a little grumbly and I challenged myself to make a film. And I went in search of a story. And the first story that I found that resonated with me was the story of Shirley Chisholm's run for president in 1972. Now, the thing about that story and why I prefaced with college and free to be you and being all of that is that I heard her birthday announced on NPR, and they said the first black woman who ran for Congress in 1968 is, her birthday is today that of Shirley Chisholm. And I thought, wow, she's still alive. And then this light bulb went off. Wow, she's still alive. We need to participate in the telling of our stories so that we're nuanced, so that we're real and realistic. And then I went to my library, because I had taken all those women's studies classes and black studies classes, and I pulled out Paula Gidding's book, When and Where I Enter. And there are 3 pages on Shirley Chisholm's run for president. I was like, she ran for president. Wow, how did I miss this? I read the book, you know? But it was hard to believe that it was this idea of symbolic annihilation and that it was something that you internalize and that you also kind of repeat. She was not possible. How could she run for president? And in the margins, I very angrily wrote something like, why would you do that when you know you're going to lose? That makes no sense. But now, fast forward 10 years, I was like, that's the story. And so I made a film about Shirley Chisholm and her run for president. I want to show you a clip, but I want to set it up and to say that this idea of symbolic annihilation plays out in many ways. Making the film, we were almost getting close to finishing it. It takes place in 1972, which is this glorious time, a beautiful time, complicated time, and I had this very out there opening sequence. This 1972 came out of the stars and came at you, split screen, you know, Vietnam, Afros, black power, everything, and towards the end, Shirley Chisholm came out. Well, this was sent to Sundance. We wanted to get it in the festival, but it was also sent to the executives at PBS in Washington, D.C. And the notes back from the opening sequence and the film was, we will never show this film. It is not up to our standards. What is this crazy opening? What is the film about? And why don't you start with Walter Cronkite, who says on the nightly news, a bonnet has been tossed into the presidential ring today, that of Congresswoman Shirley Chisholm. And I had a choice to make. Do I cut the opening out and start with Walter to make somebody else happy? Or do I try and answer that? And so I'm going to roll clip one, which is my answer, and in the opening to Chisholm 72, which did indeed get into Sundance.
I stand before you today as a candidate for the Democratic nomination for the presidency of the United States of America. I am not the candidate of Black America, although I am black and proud. I am not the candidate of the women's movement of this country, although I am a woman and I'm equally proud of that. I am the candidate of the people of America. And my presence before you now symbolizes a new era in American political history. Americans all over are demanding a new sensibility, a new philosophy of government from Washington. Our will can create a new America. In 1972, one where there's freedom from violence and war, at home and abroad, where there's freedom from poverty and discrimination, where there exists at least the feeling that we are making progress in ensuring for everyone medical care, employment, and decent housing. Those of you who can now vote for the first time, those of you who agree with me that the institutions of this country belong to all of the people who inhabit it. Those of you who have been neglected, left out, ignored, forgotten, or shunned aside for whatever reason, give me your help at this hour. Join me in an effort to reshape our society and regain control of our destiny as we go down the Chisholm Trail for 1972.
From our newsroom in New York, this is the CBS Evening News with Walter Cronkite.
A new hat, rather a bonnet, was tossed into the Democratic presidential race today, that of Mrs. Shirley Chisholm, the first black woman to serve in Congress.
So, yeah. So, as a director, I had a choice as to listen to somebody else and capitulate, or to kind of take those notes and make them mine and make sure Walter Cronkite came after Shirley Chisholm. And so my next independent project, I thought, okay, that was so difficult, it took years to make. You know what I'm going to do? I'm going to find a subject that everyone knows about, a person who everyone knows about, Angela Davis. And yeah, everybody knows about her, but I forgot how dangerous she was still perceived as. That as a former communist, as somebody who was on the FBI's most wanted list, it was very difficult to raise money for that film. And her story is not really believable. If you actually know the details of the story, and if I wrote it as a narrative script, it wouldn't be believable, but it's all true. It's a political crime drama with a love story at the center. Yeah, it's true. I'm telling you. Love story at the center, baby. Okay. And so I would pitch it, political crime drama with a love story. And I will never forget one executive. Symbolic annihilation. He said, after my riveting pitch, of course, he leaned in and said, so let me get this straight. You're only interviewing senior citizens? Who sees Angela Davis as only a senior citizen? Another executive said to me, wow, this is great, this is great, this is hot, this is hot, this is hot. He was in the music industry. He said, this is great, but really, you can make the doc do whatever you want with it. She can be the lead. But what I would like to do is make the narrative. But you have to tell me who the main male characters are, because you can't fund a movie about a woman, and definitely not a black woman, as the lead character. So I will show you the opening clip to Free Angela. It is a political crime drama with a love story at the center. That's clip two.
San Rafael, California, north of San Francisco, a judge and three other persons were shot to death today in an attempt by a group of convicts to escape.
There are still a great many loose ends and a great deal of speculation about what happened here. Investigators will now try to determine if there was a conspiracy of some kind that involved perhaps more persons than those who actually participated in the bloody event.
Today, it turned out that two of the guns used in the courtroom were bought by Angela Davis. She was the teacher fired from the University of California at Los Angeles after she said, yes, she was a communist.
And so I will only, political crime drama. And one of the things when the film came out in the world, it was at Toronto and in film festivals and in theaters, and it's now out on DVD and iTunes. And one of the things that comes out during the discussions is the improbable nature of her story, but it is absolutely true. And one aspect of that, particularly the love story, irritates people. So I thought it was really important in this context to say, yes, we are lovable, she is lovable, she loves, we are lovable, we love, and to show clip three, and then.
You might say, within the context of that confinement.
Well, I suppose as far as you're concerned, then it's no surprise that you're in solitary confinement, and I'm wondering what kind of shock that has been to your sensibilities, to your emotion.
Yeah, but see, I understood very well that the reason why the Marin County officials would not permit me to talk to any other woman in that jail was because they wanted to break me. They wanted me to respond in that way. They wanted me to feel the burden of the solitude. And I just had to make up my mind that I was not going to let it affect me that way. I think that what George Jackson said about life in prison is very appropriate here. He says that prison either breaks a person or makes the person stronger. And I would like to think that I have become stronger during this experience.
My emotional relationship with George became far more intense when I was behind bars. Part of that passion consisted in our being able to imagine ourselves as comrades, helping to usher in a new world.
When she was in prison, and when George was in prison, they had the opportunity to meet.
We met for a period of time. We had discussion, the type of things that you discuss when you have the legal meeting. And then Angela and George met separately to discuss things that only the two of them wanted to discuss with each other.
You know, it was a meeting that was really complicated and full of all kinds of emotions and feelings.
She's been locked up, and if she's had the opportunity to do some hugging and kissing, right on. That's my theory.
Thank you. those were the years of the Black Revolution. Everybody wanted to organize.
That's the end of the clip. Yes.
I'm so happy that I get a chance to talk to you both. This is wonderful. Thank you so much. So, now, the two of you work together.
We have.
Worked on a number of projects together, no?
Yes.
You're working usually as the producer, mm-hmm. right? You're the filmmaker. How do you come together on how you decide, what you decide you're going to work on? And when do you decide that you're actually going to use Lisa or vice versa to work together?
Well, Shola and I had a wonderful experience last year with a project called Imagine a Future. And thank you. Which is looking at a conversation among young sisters around the world about beauty and representation. And I think that what drew us together to tell this story was the narrative and the concept of a young woman who felt so invisible, such a lack of love in her environment, a lack of mirrors, that she went to a very painful place, but that we actually met her when she was on the road to discovering herself and her beauty uh-huh. and a new definition of beauty. Mm-hmm. We took her front to South Africa to interact with some very interesting people and places like the birthplace of Sarah Bartman, some people uh-huh. know as the Venus Hottentot. But we also brought her to the cradle of humankind, where she learns that everything started with a woman who looked exactly like her. You know,
and that's the story that you two decided yes. to tell mm-hmm. yeah, together.
It was actually a story that Lisa, she came to me with this very wonderful pitch about images and empowerment, and I was like, Lisa, you should direct this film. Why are you? And we decided actually to co-direct it uh-huh. because it was something that she was so passionate about. Mm-hmm. And so. Every film is a little bit different in terms of the vision and the passion, the director, and the producer who makes sure that gets executed.
Exactly.
But the intention, we shared yes. as, yes. you know, as mothers, aunties, sisters, mm. daughters, fierce, moving, arms akimbo, creators in the world, you know, we can't miss this moment in time to correct the wand of invisibility that some people have tried to wave upon our bodies.
Yes. You know, I have a couple of different questions. On the one hand, there are the things that you make together, like this one piece.
Imagine a Future.
Imagine mm-hmm. a Future, which I've seen parts of because you sent it to me, thank you. And then you make documentaries that are very specific about very particular kinds of women, right? You know, Shirley Chisholm.
Disruptive.
Just
argumentative.
Just, you know.
Troublemaking women.
You know, powerful,
I relate. Exactly.
Powerful. Powerful women, right? And then the clips that you showed, for the most part, come out of popular culture.
And some were films that I've produced, such
it's,
as...
Right.
Precious, or uh-huh. mm-hmm. the beautiful woman in Africa dancing. That's from a good film stuff. Called Kwaku Inanse, which will be at the African Film Festival coming mm-hmm. up. I've had a wonderful opportunity to work with Tanya on Micheline Thomas's Happy Birthday to a Beautiful Woman.
Oh, to her mother's piece, right?
Yes. You know, that I've been very lucky in both the narrative and documentary space mm-hmm. to sit down with all women, directors mm-hmm. to tell our stories. Yeah.
Uh-huh. Uh-huh. Do you think that this way that we are working, this way of kind of unpacking these complicated questions of representation beyond beauty, but that really gets to the multiplicity of our humanness. Is the story being heard? Is it changing things in a substantive way? I mean, what does it mean when you say we took this young girl who was on the other side of her disempowerment, who's coming through the other side of that, we take her to this place and we experience this thing with her? What does that mean for me? What does that mean for this audience? What does it mean for other young people who are battling? How does it make a difference?
I mean,
understand what I'm saying?
I do. And I think sometimes we want to intellectualize it, but it does make a difference. It made a difference when I saw your photographs, the mm-hmm. kitchen table series. It makes a difference. My daughter is 4. And the Angela Davis film was coming out, and the trailer, I let her watch it. She wanted to see the movie. She's not quite old enough for that. But the trailer, and she watched it over and over and over again. And she said, she identified certain people. She was like, that's Angela's mom. And this is my favorite moment. Angela said, it's genocide, it's genocide, right? But she watched it over and over again. She was obsessed with it. And why does this matter? Well, she's 4, she wants to be a princess. I'm trying to make her a warrior princess. But
that'll come later.
But the images matter. She woke up after doing this the next day or several days later, and her hair, we have big curly hair. This is what we have. And she walked by the mirror, and she said, Angela Davis hair. Just like she would say, princess hair. And so we want to say, you know, and so what I'm trying to do is, there is symbolic annihilation, and then there are the images that we create. And when we create culture, it does matter. And it exists, and nobody can take that away. So when you create a book, when you create a photograph, when you create a film, it's there for other generations to discover. So she can discover it, and then perhaps future generations.
Yes.
It exists, whether it's popular now, or not.
Mm-hmm. I love this idea of creating culture.
Yes. Right? We're cultural creators.
Right? Of building, constructing what it is that we think that we need to put into the world, to bring into the world.
Well, you know, I think, Carrie, it's about giving back permission, the permission that we always had to sit at the table, to tell our stories, to smoke, to drink, to cry, to fight. That has kind of been marginalized or one-dimensionalized mm-hmm. in a lot of popular representation. We have the keys.
Right.
We built the car.
Right.
We built the spaceship.
Right. Right.
So oftentimes, you know, the work that I'm interested in is about the wink, the nod, the gaze that reminds us of who we are and how we started all.
But we're also involved, and you're involved in some very interesting work. I mean, you're involved in, you know, you're involved in production, right? So that, you know, you're deciding and assisting somebody to decide what gets made,
mm-hmm.
right? And to a certain extent, how it gets made, and then hopefully how it gets distributed, right? So you're involved in, this thing that you are involved in, that you two specifically are involved in as filmmakers, you know, is a very specific thing, and you're looking for dynamic audience. I mean, like, who do you assume will see Chisholm? Who do you assume, for the most part, will see Angela? Who will be the audience for that?
Well, it's interesting because we create the art, and then we work with distributors who are clearly just business people. So a film about Angela Davis was only marketed via social media to urban youth. Well, what about colleges? What about universities? What about the 60-plus? Well, we don't exist really as market as audiences for in that business. And so the film has a life.
Mm-hmm.
So, you know, it's been screened. We screened it at Harvard. We screened it at Spelman. It has a life, and people engage with it. So what I hold on to is that it exists. And whether Angela is here or not, you get to meet her through the story of how she became Angela Davis, the icon.
Mm-hmm.
We take away the iconic status, and she's a 26-year-old philosophy grad student. Right?
Amazing. Right, Jack.
Same with Shirley Chisholm. I still have high school students emailing me. Oh my goodness, I saw the film. I had no idea she existed. She ran for president in 1972.
Yeah,
and the film came out before Barack Obama and Hillary Clinton.
Yeah.
So when we make these cultural artifacts, they resonate.
Mm-hmm.
And sometimes it's big and fast, like Precious, huge. And then sometimes it's a slow burn.
Well, and I think that's an interesting project because that was a slow burn. you know, 10 years of going to the author to get the rights to make the story.
With Sapphire.
Yes, with Sapphire. And an interesting thing on that project is the official title is Precious, based on the novel Push by Sapphire. And I never forget the time that we met with the distributor, and they said, well, this is about Precious, this is her story. I said, but you know what, it's also about this very important book, this book that planted a seed in my heart on the C train, seeing all these sisters reading this red and black book. And this book has community that I'm a part of. This community, this book has an audience that we just can't forget about as we go out and market and commit ad dollars in certain spaces. So, you know, as a producer, I'm there from A to Z, from the dream that the director has to finding a fabulous piece of clothing for Gabby Sidibe to wear in a Fosse dream sequence when she's wearing a feathered muumuu and cha-cha heels from my own personal collection. because it was like, you know, the costume brought something out, and I was like, no, she is center stage, and all the lights are on her, and she's not wearing this frumpy thing. I'm digging in the crates. So, but then it also goes to delivering it and building community.
What do you mean, delivering it and building community?
I think, you know, when we cannot depend that our core audience is going to be the sole audience. Who are naturally going to identify. So it is very important to make certain that, in that case, I connected with the publishing company from the beginning of the film so that they invited their salespeople so that when you went into Barnes & Noble, that book had not only the cover from the film, but it also was in the front of the bookstore. That there were initiatives done with young people, with women, with gay people that, you know, it's like, because I want everybody to come and see and learn and grow and see the possibility that exists.
I think you're fabulous. I'm hoping that you'll work with me on a project.
Signed, sealed, and delivered.
What are you working on now?
So you did Chisholm.
Did Chisholm.
Who I adored. It's a wonderful film.
Thank you.
And Angela, who I've known for many, 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 many years.
Yes. So I'm at the Schomburg as a curator, but my next film project is one where I can't make the documentary. It takes place pre-Civil War. And it's about a woman who leaves her free husband behind. She herself was a slave, commandeers herself out of slavery to the North, to freedom, and then empowers herself to become a freedom fighter and goes back over and over again to hundreds.
She's like Harriet Tubman's sister.
She is Harriet Tubman. But we don't think of her as an action heroine. Think about the brilliance it took in order to do what she did. We think of her as a little old lady. She is an action heroine.
Oh, yes.
And so it is an action movie. And it's called Harriet, Live Free or Die Trying, an action movie.
It's a narrative.
It's a narrative.
And you're writing the script.
And I'm developing the story.
And are you working with her on this one?
We've been in conversation.
I'm putting ingredients in the gumbo.
You know, there's this really funny story I have to tell you. You know, I don't have a clock here. I don't have a clock in front of me. So I have no idea how much time we have. But I suppose that you guys will tell us when it's time to quit since we don't have a clock here. Oh, thanks. Oh, good. Okay, so at least we know that. Harriet Tubman, at one point, after she'd left her husband, who was free, decided that when she went back to Maryland on her gathering trip, that she would go back to her husband, who she knew had remarried, who was living with another woman, and her name was Carrie.
I didn't know her name was Carrie.
Her name was Carrie, and Harriet knocked on their door, and she said, I know that you're with somebody else, but I know that she's a slave, and so I'd be willing to take you both. Right? Just a great story.
Great story. Great story. And again, here's this woman that we think of as an elderly woman. We think that, you know, she got on the railroad, was conductor, toot toot.
Yes.
That
yes.
we don't give her her brilliance.
Mm, yeah.
She's better than 007.
For a great strategist. But
absolutely.
Mm, great strategist.
To be a spy, that she loved.
Yes.
And lost.
Yes.
And we let all of that go. Yeah. It's the symbolic annihilation of our humanity.
Yes.
And that's not how I see history. So as a filmmaker, literally, a young person asked me this, it was a conversation about the master's gaze. And I said, well, literally my job as a filmmaker is to move the frame.
Yes.
So I can see me. Mm-hmm. Yeah. And all of us.
Yes. Yeah, that reframing.
Reframing. Which is not the same as revising. Mm-hmm. This is not revisionist history.
Yeah.
This is reframing and going back and seeing, reclaiming,
is
rediscovering.
Right? Or just simply an intervention.
We can call it an intervention.
I mean, these become sort of interesting ideas, right? I mean, because, right, since we've never really been involved with cinema, I mean, we don't have a deep, long history with cinema for the most part, right? We're in a lot of ways, we're fairly new on the scene. I remember feeling having these deep sense of unrequited love. You know, like I would get up very early in the morning to like watch Fellini movies and these sort of great films. And I was really upset that they never included anybody that looked like me. And then, of course, at a certain point, I realized that that wasn't their job. That's my job to make something that looks like me, right?
Yes.
You know, that's my priority. And and in building that, it's not without its complication. It's not without its, you know, its difficulty. You know, when Michaela was talking about, you know, what she's written on her skin, on this broken part of herself, a woman that's been negotiating sort of ideas about her, the complexity of her identity for over 50 years now. Well, many of us are still in that, we're still in that place, even as we talk about intervention,
mm-hmm.
even as we talk about developing new modes of representation, systems of representation.
But it is about commitment. It's about committing to ourselves and committing to what we're creating. I mean, that was not part of the narrative that Precious took 10 years to make. For Angela, it took 8 years to make. And life does not end at 40 or 50. And so it is committing to yourself and committing to living your ideals, not just for the first 20 years of your life. But throughout, it's lived to be 80 or 90.
Also, you know, and imagine the future. We could have done the whole film about Michaela. It had so many wonderful quotes. But you and Elizabeth Alexander said something I always think about is like this process of becoming a woman of the reveal of it all is never ending. We are constantly, you know, recircuiting and finding new pathways. So it's interesting, one of the projects I have been working on is called The Infinity Engine with Lynn Hirschman Leeson and Tilda Swinton, which is all about bioengineering and the future and how we now have the ability to change our future. But it's also about where we are in that conversation so that we don't see the Henrietta Lackses and the Tuskegee Airmen stories being perpetrated by science. So this is actually a way for me to work with both a film and an installation. We're going to have a replica of a DNA lab that travels to museums around the world that
amazing.
Is having this conversation mm-hmm. about the Infinity Engine, DNA, and our place within all of this.
Mm-hmm. Thank you so much.
Thank you
for coming. Thank you. So beautiful. You'll keep us posted.
Yes.
She'll do a Kickstarter on
Thank you.
Wonderful.